Are you new to Airtable interfaces? If so, they can seem a little overwhelming at first. But in this video, I want to break down for you truly how simple it is to implement your own interface, share it with your team, and get the most out of working inside of Airtable. So if working in Airtable interfaces is of interest to you, stick around and let's get into it. Hey, welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Gareth. I'm the owner at Gap Consulting, and we make it our mission to help you get organized and automated with no-code tools. One of our favorite no-code tools, of course, is Airtable, and here we are sharing with you today exactly how you can get working inside of Airtable interfaces. But before we get into it, I'd like to invite you to join us for an Airtable crash course. If you're relatively new to Airtable, there are tons of different features that you might not even know exist. In this crash course that we've put together, I'm going to break it down for you step by step so that over the course of a week, you really learn how to unlock the true power of Airtable. Sign up for that free crash course at garethpronovost.com/airtable-crash-course. I will include links below this video. But without further ado, let's hop right on into my screen and start talking about how we can get working with our first Airtable interface. Now, first and foremost, we always have to start with a data schema. Here in my example, I have a pretty straightforward schema. I have projects, and they are connected to clients. So on our clients table here, we're going to find that we have a company and a name of the person and an email. And then, of course, we have a formula here that's taking the name of the person and the company. And then we also have a linked relationship from clients to projects. Now, of course, when you're building your own interface, you're going to have a much more complex scenario, most likely more than just two tables, but I've kept it simple for our example here. So in our second table, back to projects, we see the name of the project, we see the client that it's connected to, and also the start date and end date, in addition to the status of the project. So we have a single select field here for approved, in progress, completed, and you'll also notice that I've linked to a project manager. Now, this is an important one because this particular field type is going to come in really handy inside of Airtable interfaces. This particular field type is the user field type, and it's saying that we can add people who are collaborators in our database or in our interface. And I'll show you exactly how we can add new collaborators when we get to that point. The reason this is really valuable, though, is we can apply filters to the interface so that people can only see those records that they're assigned to. And we'll do this in our example, but you'll see that when I apply a filter, I will only be able to see the project where I'm actually linked to it, where I am the assigned user. So keep that in mind as we're moving forward, but now let's hop into the part where we actually build an interface. So in order to do this, we go up to the top here. Notice that we are in the data portion, and of course, we always have to start with building the right data schema. But now that we like what we have, we can move over to interfaces, and this is going to allow us to build that drag and drop interface so that we can cultivate the experience of other users who are impacting or working within our system. So here we go. We start building. And we first name the interface. We can choose a color here, and we can select an icon or emoji to go along with our interface. Once we're happy with this, we can go ahead and click Next. That's all cosmetic stuff. Now you'll see that we have a bunch of different options in terms of choosing our layouts. Now, interfaces continues to make more and more advancements. So now we have the list view that we can choose from, gallery, Kanban, calendar, timeline, and then we can drill into even more. We can build a dashboard, we can add forms so that we can create new records, we can do a record review where we're drilling into one record and kind of seeing its information spread out, similar to a record summary, another option where we can get a detailed overview of a single record. Now, all of these are fantastic options, but I want to start building from scratch so that we can work with the bare elements and build things step by step as we go along. So let's go with the last option here, which is a blank canvas, and we'll say finish. Now here it is. This is our interface. This whole space is our playground. We can bring in whatever information we want from our database and assign it here. Now I want to first draw our attention to the bottom left corner where we see our elements. So we can collapse this by shrinking it down or expand it. And these are the different pieces, elements that we can take from our data schema and drop them into our interface. So let's kind of get started and imagine first what we might want. Maybe we want to put together an interface where we can track the projects that have been assigned to us. So let's do that. Now the first thing we want to do here is choose the first element, and ideally we want to select the project and then get a detailed view of that project. So searching through our elements here, we can scroll on down and we're going to find that we have an option for a record picker. So I can make this selection here and I can drop it here on the side and drag it out, make it longer and totally resize it, whatever we want to do here in terms of setting this element up. But effectively, what you'll notice is, if I go to the right-hand side of my screen, this is a record picker that's applying to a table inside of our data schema. Remember that we had clients and we had projects. So we can select what we are drawing from. Here, we want to say, well, we want our team to be able to look at their projects. So we establish the connection to projects here. Now for the next part. Inside the record picker, we get to determine if we want to apply a filter or not. Do we want people to be able to see all records? Well, we keep it toggled on here. Or do we want to drill it down to be more specific? Maybe we want to eliminate some of the records that people can see. Well, one quick and easy way to do that is to say viewer records only. So here when I make this selection, you see that it says if the viewer or their email is in the project manager. So if you recall, we have a specific field we built called project manager, which allowed us to tag people or assign people that had access, and now we can limit what they see. So again, in my case, I was only assigned to one project. So if we kept this particular filter, I would only see that one project when I log into my interface. Now, I can also drill in even more specifically. So I could say the project manager is current user. That is exactly what we had on the previous selection, viewers records only. But you'll notice that I can add additional conditions to this as well. So I might also say that the start date is in the future or in the past. This way I can further refine the projects that people can actually see when they can drill down on this record picker. Now, I'll keep it simple. I'll say just that I can only view those projects that have been assigned to me at the project manager level. If we're happy with that, we can move on. Now, in terms of options here, we can choose how we want this data to be sorted. Maybe we want it to show up in alphabetical order. Maybe we want it to show up in chronological order based on the start date. There's a lot of different options that we can set up here. But the key takeaway is that whatever we choose is going to dictate the order of information that is shown to us on that drop-down display. Now, moving on, we can also elect to give people the ability to create new projects. So here, if I toggle this on, now our users can actually create new projects through a form. They can now enter this information in the form, what's the project name, start date, etc., and they can therefore create their own new project. Now, one place where this might be dicey is if they don't have a client. So can we allow them to create a new client as well? Well, we would need to do that on a separate form. So in this particular case, they would only be able to create a new project and link it to an existing client. But if we so chose, we could also create another form for them where they could first create a new client and then assign that client to a new project. So all of this is, again, very possible inside of Airtable interfaces. Now, assuming that we're very happy with the way that this form is working, we can close it out and keep moving on inside of this drop-down element that we've added. So coming back here, our last two options then are the button label, and this is what people are going to see when they go ahead and push on this if they're going to add a new project. So we'll keep it the default, add project. And lastly, we can choose whether to show or not to show the label up here in the upper left corner of our element. So if we want it to show that this is projects, we can keep that toggled on. And it's that simple. We've now set up our first element, but there's a lot more that we can do. So now that we have added this element that allows us to pick a specific record inside of our Airtable database, now what we want to see is the detailed information about that very record. So you'll go back to the elements in the bottom left corner again, and you'll notice that now we have a new option. Previously, we only had the option of all elements, meaning that we hadn't really linked to anything yet. But now that we've established that there is a project that we've selected from a dropdown, we have a whole new element to our interface. And we can now add all the other elements from within the project record. Remember, first, we're going to pick our project, and once that project is selected, we want to see information about the project that was picked. So, we might bring in the name of the project, drop it on in right there. And of course, all of this is perfectly resizable, so we can extend the drop-down across the entire top, and then I can just bring in the project name here. Maybe I want the start date here and the end date to be right next to it, and I can just drag and drop those different elements in. I also might want to be able to see the status. Boom. And I also might want to be able to see the project manager, even though, of course, in this case, it's always going to be me because of the fact that we have established that filter. Now we get to go a layer deeper into every single element that we've included from the project. So let's go step by step. The project name. Can we edit this? Well, when we select that element, we see here that currently it is view only, but we can give permission to our interface users to allow them to edit whatever fields we want them to be able to edit, provided that the field is editable. Now, quick recap for you here. If you're working with a formula output or a lookup field or a rollup field, those particular field types are not editable. They derive their value from other calculations that are happening inside of our database, so those will not have the option to become editable. They will be view only. But we can edit any field that is editable. So the project name, this is simply a text field. We can definitely edit that. So I can mark it like this. Same thing with start date. Right? Maybe I want to give my project managers the empowerment of being able to change the start and end dates of a project if they need to. Well, I can come in here and say, you can edit that information. Same with end date, you can edit that information. Maybe we don't want them to be able to change the project manager though. If you're assigned to a project, you're stuck with it and there's no way out. And same thing with the status. Maybe status can only be changed at a manager level, so the project manager needs to, you know, go higher up the food chain in order to update the status of a project. So these are the key elements. Now we've decided what's editable, what's not editable. We can also go into every single field that we've added here and alter the appearance. You'll notice that in this case, for status, it can be small or large, just making it a little bit bigger. And of course, we can also impact the label, so we can toggle that on or off. Depending on the type of field that you're working with, your options here will be a little bit different. This is a date field, so I have default and large. And again, I have show the label or not. This particular field is a user field, so I have a slightly different, you know, option here, default and large, whereas over here I had small and large. So relatively the same options for each different element, but notice that they'll be slightly different depending on the field type. Now, once you're ready to get this thing out in the world, we can now publish it. So make sure you've set everything the way you like it and then publish this particular scenario. Once we've published, we can then take it out for a spin. And of course, if we need to invite other people to join us in this workspace, we can. Quick word of caution here though, anybody that you add into this interface will get access to the interface, including whatever permissions you've established in the interface, edit capabilities and whatnot, except for read-only. Read-only is not going to incur charges for you, but commenter and editor permission types will absolutely incur charges for you, and you will be billed on your Airtable plan for adding new users. Now, bear in mind that this does not add the users to the backend database. This does allow you to share limited access to your Airtable data only in the way that you want your users to interact with it, and does not share all of the information that is there in the database itself. Now let's imagine that you're very happy now with the people that you've added to your interface. You can move on to the next stage, which is basically testing this thing. So here I am logged in as myself, and of course when I go to the dropdown, I can only see the one project because I've only been assigned to that one project. When I make that selection, flying high, you'll see that I can edit the name of the project. Maybe it's flying low. Boom, just edit it right there in line. I can alter the start date. I can alter the end date. And I cannot impact the status or the project manager. Now again, ideally there's someone else in your organization, probably you, whoever you are, who actually is monitoring all of this information and building this in Airtable. Now that particular individual or team is going to be able to access the raw data. So if you need to, they can come in and add new project managers, they can remove people from projects, etc. So this is like admin level permissions in the raw data itself. But the interfaces, which we can flip back to very quickly, are the thing that is available only to the people that you share the interface with, and they can only see and edit the information that you made available to them. I know we went really quick in this video because, let's face it, interfaces is a big topic and there's a lot to unpack. So as I mentioned earlier, be sure to check out my free training that I have linked below. And of course, if you want to stay on top of no-code news just like this, be sure you've subscribed to this channel so you don't miss out on future videos. That's it for this one. In the meantime, keep on building. Cut that. An icon? Emoji? You can select